Good evening, and welcome to our Fletcher Hills Presbyterian Church Christmas Eve worship experience. I am thrilled that you've taken the time to be with us this evening. Merry Christmas to every one of you. What a year it's been. But what better time for us to gather together in the light of the hope of Christ and celebrate what the greatest gift the world could ever receive does in our lives today. We celebrate Jesus this evening, and what a thrill it is to be together for this experience. In just a moment, we're going to begin our worship experience with the lighting of the Christ candle. The Suhonen family will lead us through this. And there are a few chances for you to be a part of this, for you to join in speaking corporately with words that will appear on your screen. So I invite you now to have your candles ready and to be ready to join in wherever you are. But as we begin this time of worship now, please join me in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we give you praise and thanks on this Christmas Eve for the joy that you have given us in your Son, Jesus Christ. We celebrate his light as it enters into a dark world, giving us hope, giving us joy, giving us peace, and giving us strength as we make our way through these days. And so we commit our time to you now, our worship that we are about to offer, and we pray on this Christmas Eve that it would bring you the glory you deserve. We pray all of these things together in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Advent hope moves us. Advent love leads us. Advent joy stirs us. Advent peace stills us. All that we might affirm this evening, the arrival of our King and Savior, Jesus Christ.
O come, Emmanuel.
It is time that we set flame to this Advent affirmation by lighting the Christ candle.
We believe that Jesus is the Son of God. He was born of the Virgin Mary in Bethlehem. He is the long-awaited Messiah whose coming was prophesied. This same Jesus resides within us today, and he is worthy of our highest honor and our passionate commitment. In Jesus Christ, our hope is fulfilled, our faith is consummated, our joy is complete, and our peace is sealed. We rejoice, our Savior is born, joy to the world.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare in room. Let heaven and nature sing and heaven.
In these times of physical distance and uprooted routines, it is so good to spend Christmas Eve with my FHPC family. So wherever you are and whoever you are with as you watch this service, it is good to be together. I want to offer just a few announcements to keep in mind as we look ahead to the new year at Fletcher Hills Presbyterian Church. Your pastor, elders, and staff are already preparing for 2021. Small groups, children's education, youth programs, and service through our mission partners, all the things that connect us between Sunday's worship services. Stay in touch with our weekly update via email on Wednesdays at about 1 p.m. If you're not already receiving the update, please let the office know, or sign up on our website at fhpc.org. Also, our deacons remain active, connecting with parishioners and meeting needs as they arise. If we can be of help, or if you'd just like to catch up with one of our deacons, please call the church office and let us know. We will be happy to be in touch. And lastly, FHPC will continue to worship virtually as we make our way into 2021. Each week's worship service premieres Sundays at 10 a.m. on our YouTube channel. And we'll be here this Sunday, the 27th. Join us for worship and stick around for our Zoom coffee hour and connect with us. If you miss us on Sunday, worship and other videos are available to watch on your own schedule. Now, let's return to our worship service.
Of wandering love, oh. Good evening, boys and girls. Merry Christmas Eve. We are just one night away from Christmas, and I am so excited. Now, this evening, I brought something special with me. I brought this. It is my hedgehog ornament. Now, someone gave me this a couple Christmases back, and it is such a special gift because I love hedgehogs and I love Christmas. So, because this is so important to me, every single year I hang it up on my tree. Now, I've got a lot of ornaments and a lot of decorations, but because this is so important to me, I always make room for it. No matter how cluttered my tree is, no matter how much stuff is on it, this is important. So I always make space for it. This is important. So I always make space for it. And what that reminds me of is in the Christmas story, Mary and Joseph arrive at Bethlehem, but the town is so busy and so overrun with people that there was no room for them anywhere. There was no room for them. They had to sleep outside in a dark, damp, stinky, smelly cave because there was no room for them. And so the question I want to ask you boys and girls is, what is important to you? Is God important to you? Is Jesus important to you during this Christmas time? Because if he is, then what we need to remember is to make room for him, right? Because when things are important to us, we make space for them. Now, Christmas time and life gets very busy. We might be busy with school, with sports, with friends, with family. There are so many things going on in life. I know there are. And if you forget about God or if you don't have space for God, that does not mean you're bad. That just means you're busy. But what I want you to remember, really remember, that when things are important to us, we should always make space for them, right? And so if God and if Jesus are truly important to us, what I want you to remember, when you look at your Christmas tree and you see all your ornaments and you see, oh, there is always space for them, that you remember I should make space for God in my life, that I never get so busy that I forget what's truly important and to make space for it. So that is it for me tonight. I am so excited for Christmas. I hope you're as excited as well. And I hope that you remember to always make space for what is important.
Offspring of the Virgin's womb, veiled in flame. flesh the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. Please with us in flesh to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Have you ever taken a long road trip with family or friends? Everything always starts out so well. Everybody is so excited for the trip and especially for the destination. But then, usually a few hours into the trip, the inevitable, dubious question is asked. Are we there yet? Usually comes from the back seat, not always from children, but somebody is wondering, have we made our way to the destination yet? Or how long is it going to take us to get to the place we are so excited to reach? It's an innocent question. It's not meant to perturb the people who are driving or navigating the trip. It's just someone who anticipates in a beautiful way all of the excitement that will be at the destination once that destination is reached. If we were to summarize 2020, maybe that question would do a good job. Are we there yet? Have we finished with this yet? Have we fully navigated everything that we've been up against? Can we finally be on the other side? 2020 has taught us so many lessons, but maybe now more than ever, we as believers in Christ are ready to truly step into this Advent season, into what it feels like to wait for something, to long for something, to long for rescue from something. In Advent, we identify with the nation of Israel. Israel had waited thousands of years for a Savior to come. In essence, they were saying, are we there yet? Or rather, is he here yet? They wanted the presence of God. They wanted that promised Savior to come to rescue them from their darkness, to rescue them from their turmoil, to rescue them from their enemies. And so we, in our celebration of Advent this year, say together with Israel, is he here yet? We're going to do that this evening with Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 through 7. A beautiful description of both the darkness that Israel was in and the promised light that was to come. And so I'll begin reading now in Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 1. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. A beautiful text with beautiful promises of hope. But in order to fully understand the brightness of what Isaiah describes in chapter 9, we need to spend a few moments in the last few verses of chapter 8, because the darkness that is referred to in chapter 9 is described in vivid detail in these two verses, verses 21 and 22. Distressed and hungry, they will roam through the land. When they are famished, they will become enraged, and looking upward will curse their king and their God. Then they will look toward the earth and see only distress and darkness and fearful gloom, and they will be thrust into utter darkness. Those last two verses, they describe right where the nation of Israel was as they awaited the promise of their Messiah, as they longed for light to come and rescue them. Isaiah says they are distressed, they're hungry, they're enraged, they're even to the point where they are cursing their God. Isaiah sees only anxiety, fearful gloom, and utter darkness, and it's into that space that the light of Christ comes. And we see mention of that light in verse 1 of chapter 9. And verse 1 begins with perhaps one of the most beautiful words in the English language. That word, nevertheless. Nevertheless carries power. Nevertheless can reverse what's come before. It reverses the words before, the sentences before, the paragraphs before, the stories before. No matter how dark something has been, nevertheless turns it on its head, reverses its power, and introduces the possibility of something brand new and beautiful. Isaiah says, nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. Why? Well, Isaiah offers three reasons. First, because a light has dawned. The light that has dawned is a great light, and it's dawned on those living in a great shadow, even the shadow of death. Secondly, because the people have seen it. They've recognized the darkness that they're in, and perhaps because of that great darkness, they are better able to see the light, God's great light given in Jesus. And finally, because a child is born, and not just any child. The Messiah has arrived, the divine light, and not just a beautiful human baby, but the very incarnation of God. This was the promised Savior, the promise of God's presence, Emmanuel, God with us. The true light has come. And John says it best in his prologue to his gospel. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. Now, it's not just enough for the light to arrive. The light needs to be recognized. The question is, did the people see the light? Did the people receive the light? Did the people embrace the gift of the light that was given in Jesus Christ? Well, verses 2-5 provide strong evidence that at least some of them did. Let's take just a moment to look back at what Isaiah describes. He says, a light has dawned. The people have seen a great light. God has enlarged the nation. God has increased their joy. God has shattered the tools of their oppressors. Now, Isaiah is speaking to the people of Israel some 700 years before Jesus would arrive. 700 years. And that's what prophets do. They stand where they are with the people of God, and they speak the truths of God, often pointing to the future and declaring how faithful God will be in that future. And so Isaiah describes the arrival of this light. But did you notice in his description something interesting? Every single one of those verbs is a past tense verb. Isaiah is talking about the arrival of someone who will come 700 years from now, but he uses past tense verbs. He's using a literary device that is called the prophetic perfect. It's when a past tense verb is used to describe a future event. It was one of the favorite tools of the prophets, and they would use this tool when they wanted to express a level of assurance about what they said. when they wanted the people who were listening to realize that there was a sure hope that what they described would in fact take place. Isaiah tells Israel, this is a redemption that is real. It hasn't fully arrived yet in its power, but it is so real that I'm describing it as if you've already experienced that redemption. Isaiah believed this prophecy was as good as done. What beautiful hope for him to speak into darkness. And so maybe tonight, we as a people, we're asking ourselves that same question. Are we there yet? Have we arrived? When is this pandemic going to come to an end? And I can't tell you. But I think that what Isaiah has to say in this passage should bring us hope. I think were Isaiah with us this evening, he would declare in the prophetic perfect that deliverance has come, that redemption has arrived, that healing has spread across our land, that light has come to dispel the darkness that we're currently existing in. There is a promise of hope that comes from a living God, even in the midst of darkness that we have experienced in this past year. Are we there yet? I'm not sure. Is he here yet? Yes, indeed. Jesus arrived on the scene some 2,000 years ago in miraculous fashion. And on a night like this, we remember that arrival. We celebrate how unassuming it was. And we celebrate his life, his ministry, his crucifixion, and his resurrection. Is he here yet? Yes, Jesus is here with us right now. Jesus dwells in us and among us through the powerful and mystical experience of the Holy Spirit. Is he here yet? We long for Jesus' return, when the fullness of his kingdom will come, when he doesn't whisk us away to another place, but instead brings the power of his kingdom, the power of the rhythms that he describes for his people on earth now. He brings the fullness of that kingdom to bear on a world that so desperately needs that hope, that power, that purpose, and that joy. This Christmas Eve, may each of us live in the beautiful reality of the prophetic perfect. And may each of us live in the beautiful hope of Jesus' imminent return. May we all believe this promise, because truly, it's as good as done. Merry Christmas to each and every one of you. Amen.
Tonight I'd like to begin our prayer time with a poem offered by Christine Stein. Child of promise, revealer of God, bringer of life, come. Come not as a distant emperor, but as a helpless babe. Come not as a prince in a palace, but as a displaced and frightened refugee. Come not as a man of power, but in love and compassion. We wait in joyful expectation. Come to the beaten and battered. Come to the despised and rejected. Come to all in whom the divine image is still distorted. We wait in hopeful anticipation. Come to those outcast like shepherds in the field. Come to foreigners like magi watching from afar. Come to rich and poor, young and old, male and female. We wait with all the peoples of the earth. Come to bless all creation with your love. Come to bring salvation on the earth. Come to rule with justice and in peace. Come, child of hope, we welcome your coming. Lord, as we pray on this Christmas Eve 2020, we recognize you are not only the babe in a manger, but you were and are the living presence of God among us. As we have set aside the trappings of the season for this time together, we welcome you afresh into our busy lives. We welcome you to our family tables. We welcome you into our communities, our schools, and our workplaces. We welcome you into all the places where we serve others. We welcome you into the dark places of our souls, where only your love and transformative power can reach. Come, Lord Jesus. The time of waiting is over. Our hearts are open and ready to receive you. Amen.
Long lay the world
So